Good evening, and welcome to the Revamped Rant podcast. I'm not sure if I'm really going to do this, like, officially as a podcast or anything, but I figure it might be fun, and then people can see, like, where my thoughts are at in regards to college football. Sometimes I'll mix in a little bit of life in there, just because it might make sense to college football, like, with a what I'm about to talk about right now. I mean, it's not really directed at college football, but it's to kind of give you context about how real life works in college football. Like, if you watched my Reedy Creek, the Reedy Creek video with Disney, because I'm not sure most people know, but like for the past 60 years or so, Disney has literally had its own country with the Reedy Creek, I forgot what it's called, something development. So they pretty much said, hey, you know, this was the whole Epcot Center and the City of the Future. If anybody like followed Walt Disney and is as old as I am, they always had this thing from back even before I was born where they had like the City of the Future and whatever. And then I guess sometime in the 60s, you know, they went to the Florida government and said, hey, you know, we'll build a city and we'll maintain it and do everything. And so, but we want, you know, like, you know, there's, so they gave them this autonomous Reedy Creek investment district or whatever to get this all going. And now, 60 years later, you know, we're figuring out all the shenanigans that Disney's been up to. And it's kind of interesting that, like I said in the Reedy Creek video, the one I came out with my first rant, it's kind of interesting that they came out about this at the same, like, Florida legislature released it right after FSU got snubbed, right? That's the interesting part, because even though, like, you know, ESPN is Disney, let's just face it, like, so I think what they, you know, like, if you go through and read the documents, which has, I'm just going to do a brief overview and show you, then you'll see that it's like this is Disney's par for the course, pretty much. So I'm just going to show you a few things. You're probably looking at the tabs up top and you can see. So I want to go back to ACC expansion. And this was a hot contested issue at the beginning of the season. And rightly so, because if you're Florida State or you're a Clemson, what benefit does adding Cal and Stanford have? And, you know, like, they're talking pure nonsense about, oh, the West Coast, we have access to San Francisco market. San Francisco, where, for real, that's what you are, that's what you're banking on. It's like, have you seen Stanford home games? Have you seen Cal home games? Have you seen these home games? Like, it's not even a joke. They can barely fill up 20% of their stadium. So I don't even know, like, what the point is of adding these teams for. Like, even the own student section doesn't even show up to these games practically. I was looking, there is actually a picture of Cal and Stanford at their home games, and I don't even see their student section. Now, SMU's might be a little bit different, because at least you get access, you know, to the Dallas area, and that is football. You know, Texas, Dallas, football, yes. So, you know, it is, that makes more sense to a certain degree, and they're willing to pay for themselves, so you know, you get the added revenue from SMU coming in, and they're paying, you know, their SMU, so they got money. You know, like Dallas, Texas, oil money, all that kind of stuff. You know, they have money, so they can fund their own athletic department for the 7 years, I believe, that they want to, that they said they were going to do so, or however long, 4 to 7 years. But Stanford and Cal, like, there's no football add value to adding them. Because even if you add them, okay, yeah, you get good academics and, yeah, you know, you have your rowing team has a good some good competition to face, I guess, but for football, like, you're losing money with travel and everything. And who was the team that flipped and all of a sudden NC State? And who does Boo Kerrigan is the AD of? NC State. So you could see, like, NC State's what's it cited as key to ACC expansion. You know what I mean? Like, it's just weird. Like, see, like, sources told ESPN that Woodson flipped his vote Friday after he had previously joined Clemson, Florida State, and UNC Chapel Hill in dissenting from expansion. Here's the kicker. Woodson issued this statement today. The NC State brand and historical competitiveness of our program is already well recognized and established. You sure about that? The addition of these outstanding universities gives us even greater opportunities to build on the Wolfpack's national presence. Really? What national presence? You're gonna go to San Francisco and no one's gonna watch you. National presence? You're gonna literally have to travel with your own fans to the game. And it's not like there's tons of Florida State fans and FSU fans and ACC fans in California. It's not like you're in Michigan and you've been playing in the Rose Bowl for the, Big Ten, and you've been playing in the Rose Bowl for the past 80 years, 100 years. So you have fans there. No, you don't have anything there. Lot, not, yeah, let's continue. Which in turn will generate long-term benefits for student athletes, our athletic programs, and our loyal fan base. Like, really? So you're gonna send your student athletes on these long trips. I'm pretty sure, you're going to California. I mean, well, you're going to San Francisco, so I mean, they ain't gonna really appreciate it that much. 'Cause let's face it, San Francisco ain't what it used to be. Yeah, the move will add $50 to $60 million. Really? Split up amongst what? 14 teams? Plus Notre Dame? So this is nothing. It's pittance. Small fry things. The other thing is, it's like, who's heading these things up? Laura Bush. Condoleezza Rice. Yeah, and I guess when at this year they're making 12 mil 10 million less than the Big Ten and SEC, but after this year is it going to be a lot more than 10 million less? I think if Florida State leaves, and if they can, like, when they get out, they can make 40 million more a year. So, completely, it seemed like it's this started from here. Now, I just came and skipped across this article and I thought it was interesting. Here's Boo Kerrigan. Like, let me tell you something. Does this look like the man, the face of a man that you can trust to have your back and to, like, be, when I say have your back, like, to stand up to the talking suits and the pundits and the ESPNs and whatever? Does this look like the type of guy that looks like he has that type of backbone? Does he look like he has that type of spine? No, but what's this article? College fans troll Boo Kerrigan after finding his relationship to Tim Kerrigan. This also explains the dumbass interviews with zero pushback. So yeah, what is this about? The internet found out that Boo Kerrigan has a brother named Tim, who is a VP at ESPN. Nothing to see here, right? I mean, it's just, yeah. So it's going through all the tweets. it looked like collusion since the start. Da, 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 da. This is what made me go back and check to with the NC State, because with the expansion and how they flipped. Because I'm like, hold on a second. Wasn't it NC State was the one that flipped? So then I went, I'm like, okay, let me start checking and look about this and see what kind of happened here. And it's just kind of interesting because it was like they had to go to ESPN and try and, like get the more money. We're adding these teams. How much more money can you give us, kind of thing. And it seems to me like because I already said, if ESPN is Disney, so it seems to me like ESPN pretty much told them, is like, yeah, that extra money that we're gonna give you if SEC is if Bama is not in this thing, you ain't getting nothing, because there ain't gonna be no ESPN like that. We'd be firing people because they need that money. There's no help coming from Disney because they have to still, ESPN, they go, they're a subsidiary, they go, they pay their money, they get their revenue and all that stuff and everything, and then after, from the advertisings and everything and blah blah blah, and then after they pay their expenses and all the profits and everything, that goes up to Disney, and then Disney goes and then they get their profits from all their other subsidiaries, Lucasfilm, Marvel, Disney Discovery, ABC, they go Disney Plus. So all the theme parks, yeah, all the different subsidiaries, ESPN included, they go, they pay their expenses, and then those profits get absorbed up into the Disney Corporation. And Disney Corporation, they do their thing. But if Disney Corporation is pretty much flopping at the box office, flopping at the theme parks, everywhere they're flopping on Disney Plus, losing money left, right, and center. Now they in California, there's a 900, I believe it's either 900 or 9,000. I think it might even be 9,000. I made a thing on this. 9,000, even 900, 900, 9,000, it don't matter. 900, 9,000 women just got recently, I think it was 2 days ago, just recently got certified for a class action lawsuit for unfair pay, gender pay gap stuff. Now, whether they win the lawsuit, stuff like that's hard to prove. They've done this stuff with the BBC, and it's in the end, the one they did with the BBC, they ended up having to pay the men more because the men were just working way more hours. So they ended up paying the men more. And that really was what came of that lawsuit. So it really didn't matter, but whether they win or lose, the publicity's bad. And the lawyer fees are going to be horrendous. So that's more money down the drain. And if you do lose, yeah, you're settling with nine, even just 900 women. That's a lot of settling. So, Disney's not in a place where they can say, hey, you know what? We got your back if Bama doesn't make the playoffs or anything. No, I'm pretty sure the call came from Bob Iger himself and said, get Bama in those playoffs. We need that revenue ASAP. Because I don't think they can go through this fiscal year missing $150 million after the year they had. I think once you add up, and this is a conservative estimate, once you add up all the flops at the box office this year, you're talking record breaking. Like they've lost $1.5 billion. This is, like after, you pay for marketing and the actual cost of the movies, the studios only get, when you see, oh, this movie made 50 or $1 billion. Yeah, they only get half of that money. The theaters get the other half. It averages to half. Because in the States, I believe they take 55%. And China, it's like they get 30% or 40%. And in Europe, they get 45%. So it averages about, they get half the money from the box office. When you hear, oh, global box office, Marvel's did so good, it made, whatever, 500 million. They only get to keep 250 million of that. That's what the studio gets. That's what Disney gets, 250 million. And then most of these films that they're making cost 300 million minimum before marketing. Marketing is separate. You have to add on another 100 million. So they're spending 400 million on these films, and the films are only grossing 500, 600, 700 million. So they're lucky if they get the 700 million, because then they kind of break even. But they're like, what? They can barely make it past 200 million now. So Disney's in trouble. No one's going to the parks anymore. They've priced out the families. It's too. There's a report from an economist that just came out where they said, yeah, the average family is now priced out of Disneyland or Disney World or whatever, of Disney. They can't go to the parks anymore. It's like $2,000 or something like that for a family of six just for the day, when it used to cost $200. So they've completely priced out the average family out of Disney. So I don't know who's going to these parks now. That. So yeah, it's done. But the thing I want to show you is from the last video before I finish it off, because I don't want this one to go on like the last one, that's too long. This is the audit for, I'll just scroll up to the top. Report on past practices of the Reedy Creek Improvement District. Their improvement district. Because, yes, Disney was supposed to improve the district. That was the whole point that they got this semi-autonomous government. It was supposed to be autonomous from even Disney. They were supposed to oversight, they were supposed to oversee Disney. But look, let me scroll back down again. I believe it will be. Yes. I want to start from here. So, negative outcomes. Because you can go, you can find this online, and, it's been released by the Florida legislature and all that stuff. Or by the people for the Florida legislature. But I'm not going to go into the body of these. I just want you to look at the negative outcomes at the titles. So negative outcomes, 1A. So be prepared. We're going to go through this for a minute. Compromised integrity. Sound familiar? Lack of transparency. Questionable purpose. Limited function. Potential corruption. Urban planning. I mean, but evaluation of former Reedy Creek Improvement District. Lack of governing and conflicts of interest policies. Maybe having your brother as a vice president on the board of the college football playoff committee is a little bit conflict of interest. I don't know. Lack of independence, lack of transparency. You see these things are coming. Conflicts of interest. City's bias at taxpayers' expense. So as I was saying before, pretty much the Reedy Creek Improvement District. They were biased towards Disney, even at the public taxpayer expense. Everything was done for Disney to improve Disney. So, think of it as like a everything was done for ESPN to make sure ESPN doesn't go broke. Lack of intergovernmental and community relations. That can kind of transfer over as well. Agency capture, poor governance practices, agency capture. Does anybody think that now that they may have captured the College Football Playoff Committee because of their dominance in college football? Does this thing sound familiar? Disney annual passes. So what little benefits and VIP perks are they giving for, to Boo Kerrigan and these people under the table to go along with the plan? Because part of this thing was with the government capture, the CFP might actually believe it's in their best interest to serve ESPN's best interest, which is what happened in Reedy Creek. So don't think the apple falls far from the tree. I mean, I could keep going about this for hours because this is the largest corporate corruption, cronyism in US history. 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 Discounts on cruises, discounts on discounts. So let's see where these guys go vacation. Maybe you might just see them at Disney World all of a sudden. Yep. Other Disney benefits, relevance of agency capture. This is the big one right here. Agency capture. Yeah. The College Football Playoff Committee is supposed to be like this little separate little thing from everybody, and there's all these little voices that come together that have input. But what if you capture the College Football Playoff Committee? What if you make the College Football Playoff Committee believe that ESPN's interest is the college football players' in best interest, whether it is or isn't for college football? These are questions we need to start asking. Because they're trying to separate these two. It's like, oh, Disney's all the way over there, and ESPN's all the way on the other side over there. There's a big space in between Disney. No. This is related. This is completely related. See, favoritism towards Disney. Once you get agency capture, favoritism towards ESPN, Disney. ESPN is Disney. Improper spending controls. So, yeah. This is a good read, guys. If you want to understand how ESPN, Disney, and why you think what happened the way it happened happened, we're never going to get all the answers. But you can formulate some of the, you can get most of them by just understanding how does Disney work? How does the parent corporation work? Because the subsidiary is going to follow the lead of the parent corporation. So if, like the apple doesn't fall from the far fall far from the tree, the sins of the father become the sins of the son. I don't know whatever how many more sayings you want me to keep going. I could probably keep going if I can, give me some time, I could think of a few more. But this is what's going on. Agency capture. Agency capture. They have taken control of the College Football Playoff Committee. So unless you are a Big Ten and then you have Fox on the other side, which is the other main behemoth, because they can't go against Fox, but ACC is with ESPN. So you little bro. You're not big. ACC is now little bro on the docket. Because before, remember, the SEC, I believe, starting next year, they're doing all the SEC games. They're only doing SEC. There's no more CBS. CBS is now with Big Ten, doing Big Ten games, which is what they just started this year. So I believe even this year, it started the transition where CBS has done some games for the SEC, but it's not like before where they did all the main big games, the what's it called, Bama LSU and all those games are on ESPN. So it's like, the transition over. It's like, okay, yeah, now we start the contract. We get first slot at the whatever games we want, and then by next year, CBS is fully out of the SEC and they're with the Big Ten now. So the ACC, you're little bro at like what, 36 million a year? You're little bro now. If they want they will just kick you to the side. Because gotta feed Big Bro. Because they're paying Big Bro 80, I think after it'll be like what, 110 million a year or some shit like that. They're feeding Big Bro. You still on 36 million a year for the next 10, 12 years. Yeah, 12 years you on 36 million. So you really being relegated into group of five. You are now group of five. And then especially when you add Stanford and Cal, maybe SMU is okay. They're now ranked. They're gonna finish the year in the rankings. So that was okay. That was a good, like that was a, getting SMU, you're ranked, beautiful, perfect. We need all the help we can get. Ranked ahead of Clemson even. Whether that's true or not, whether it's Clemson, I'm not saying. That's a different discussion. If SMU faces Clemson on the field, who would win? Who cares? The point is, you made a good buy. SMU is in the rank top 25. You're good. Stanford and Cal, they're nowhere near the top 25. I don't think they're near the top 50, if you were to ask me. Because I know in SP Plus, they're not anywhere near that. I don't even think they're even close to, I think they're in the 80s. So I don't know what Power 5 team adds teams that are in the 80s. Those are MAC teams. That's Conference USA. Even MAC teams are better than 80s now. It's the trashiest MAC teams that are, or the trashiest Power 5 teams that are in the 80s. So, what are you doing adding those teams? Unless, like ESPN told you, like, yeah, add these teams because, yo, bro, you go in group of five on you. Because you're group of five now. End of story. And they've made sure they had the agency capture to rub it in. So FSU, Norvell, any of the administration, I guess you probably heard what I said because after my last video, not 2 days later, reports came out, you go into the Big Ten. Not 2 days later. So if you're listening, forget about UNC, forget about Clemson, forget about these bum schools. Just take Georgia Tech and run to the Big Ten. Georgia Tech is it. All you want is Georgia. Sweet Georgia. That's it. Just Georgia Tech. That's all you need. Just take Georgia Tech, run to the Big Ten. Georgia Tech, if you listen in, talk to FSU, get out. I know, even if you don't, even if the Big Ten doesn't give you Georgia Tech the full 90 million or whatever it is, even if it's just they say 70 million, 60 million, that's enough for you to build your program up. Even if it's 60 million for the first 2, 3 years or whatever, that's still better than what you're gonna get. And I will allow you to build your athletic department up. Yeah, it's gonna be a little bit of a slow process because FSU might hit the ground running at a full pay as a full member, paying mem as a full receiving member of media rights and everything like that. But one, the Big Ten looks out for each other for the most part. I mean, unless you're Michigan, and then everybody's against it's Michigan against everybody. But for the most part, as a even with that, as a As a conference, even with that inner little thing going against other conferences, they still stick together. And two, you're gonna have access to great teams, Georgia Tech, so you're gonna get to play much more interesting matchup than you had in the ACC. Yeah, you're gonna get the Washingtons, you're gonna get the Oregon, so you're gonna get the Michigans, the Ohio States, and they're gonna all want to come play in Georgia. They're all gonna want to come down and play in Georgia. So though that's revenue. Once you get an Ohio State in the once you get an Ohio State, a Michigan, these fans also travel well. The Big Ten fans have always traveled well. So you know that even if your own fans can't come fill up the stadium, the Big Ten fans will come, the fill the stadium for you, put money in your pocket. Florida State, Georgia Tech, both of you, join hands, align up, and get out now. Get out now. Georgia Tech, the reason why I tell you get out now, it might be harder to get out later, and if you get out now, you are Georgia. You have ripe recruiting grounds. So take your ripe recruiting grounds. You see, SEC, they already have Georgia. Bulldogs. So you are not really a priority. Yeah, they might think of the rivalry, blah, 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 but these things can just be done in non-conference if you really want to play each other. The Big Ten, they need ripe recruiting grounds. So you have something to offer. You could probably go and use your recruiting ground, your recruiting footprint ground, as a play to get full pay, to get full media rights right now, if you do it right now. If you wait until the ACC goes belly up and you're with SMUs and Cals and all these trash teams, Duke and, yeah, if you're with these teams, yeah, it may not work in your favor in the future. Right now, the Big Ten, they've had problems in the Midwest with population demographics. You got to make that play now. Because especially once you start getting the Californias, the West Coast schools and everything coming in, that might be downplayed in the future a bit more. So you got to play it now while the recruiting is... Because the thing that Big Ten teams lack is access to high talent. Now, if you are in the Big Ten, it's easier for you to recruit your own talent and talent in the area because you could say, yeah, you know what, we play... You can get to go out to Washington, UCLA. They're going to come here. So UCLA can say, hey, you know, this we play two games against Georgia Tech. So, you know, you'll be able to come home, whatever it needs. You have something to sell. Right now, you have nothing to sell, Georgia Tech. You ain't got nothing to sell. What are you going to sell? Oh, yeah, we're come play at our school. We're about to be group of five. Yeah, no, that ain't going to work. So, yeah, you... Florida State, call each other up, FSU, take the initiative, call Georgia Tech up right now, tell him, yo, listen to this guy, he's the guy who predicts stuff, he's the guy who predicted that you would beat UNC, I got the videos are there, the guy who predicts things, yeah, get out now, all right? That is the, I guess, maybe I should call it the Angry Man's Revamp Rant. I don't know. I'm still working on the title, but yeah. We'll go with the NCAA Revamped Rant for now. But yes, that has been it. I showed you all everything. These are the things that I see. Because you know what? Being in Canada, I'm not caught up in your culture. And in Canada, we don't really have culture here. It's soulless. At least in the U.S., you're trying to be like Canada, but there's pushback. Keep your culture. Keep your Americana. You don't want to be like Canada. Trust me. You don't want to be like Canada. You don't want to give up on the things that made you American. Because Canada, we're giving up, or we've, we're pretty much almost there, giving up on the things that are making us Canadian, and we're suffering for it. So, looking at the outside in it, you guys... I'm not caught up in emotions and everything the same way you guys are. I am caught up in it because I follow it. But it's different if I was in Florida and I grew up in Florida and everything. You know what I mean? The emotions would be too much. And then I'd be thinking emotionally, not rationally. Since I am not really in it, even like as a Michigan fan. I'm not, since I didn't grow up in Michigan, I didn't, you know, like, I'm not really too heavy, hardcore, like, yeah, the rivalry is the rivalry, you know, like, I hate Ohio State, but it's different because I didn't grow up in it, you know what I mean? If you grow up in it, or if I was to be even, like, a football player, and I went to the school, and I played in it, and I would say indoctrinated, but indoctrinated is not the right word because, you know what I mean? It's something that it goes along with the culture of the university, of the conference, of everything. So it's just like, you know, you're involved in it. You've lived it. I haven't had that experience, but I've watched it from afar, from the outside looking in, so I can see, you know, I see what it is. So I just look at things more rationally when it comes to college football because I don't really get a chance to be a part of it like I would like, which is probably why I started this because, you know what, it gives me a chance to be more involved in college football because it's really the only thing like I ain't like, even though I'm a basketball player, can't stand the NBA. It is trash on hot garbage with cat piss on top, pissed on top of it. Like, yeah. The NBA is like, I don't even know. And I used to love watching the NBA, like back with when Dwayne Wade was normal and he just played basketball. Yeah, I used to love watching the NBA. Like Dwayne Wade, I think that era when like Dwayne Wade, Malice at the Palace, that Malice at the Palace, that was the turning point for the NBA, really. After that, it just went super soft because, you know, like that was a turn, that was a, you know, one of those like watershed moments. But yeah, can't stand the NBA. Hockey is eh. I mean, it's there. Everybody here is like, you know, Toronto hockey fan, Montreal, everywhere you go, hockey, hockey, hockey. That's, you can't go in, yeah, Toronto, Raptors, or Leafs. That's it. That's that. Those are the only two ones. So, really, it started a long time ago. 20 years ago, I would say, maybe what? No, 30 years ago. On a fateful day, the Fab Five were formed, and I used to be a basketball player. So that's just how I got into it. And then, you know, like Notre Dame games were always on. So Saturday morning in Canada, or afternoon, after Saturday morning cartoons, there's nothing on back in 1992. So, unless you want to watch infomercials, you're watching the Notre Dame game. Or you're watching the Michigan game. Or, you know, you're watching college football on Saturday. So that's my exposure to college football. I'm gonna probably cut the last part about this out, but yeah. Actually, no, I'm just gonna leave it in. Good to give a little bit of background on what I'm doing, why I do what I do, where I'm from. Not that I care. If people want to come dox me, come dox me. It's like, it's whatever. But you see now, man's brother is vice president at ESPN. Now, you know, if, so I'll give you an example. Ward Manuel, he is on the committee. He is the athletic director for Michigan. When they're talking about Michigan, he has to leave the room. How is it that this guy can have a conflict of interest and he doesn't have, he's there? Isn't like, wouldn't ESPN have a conflict of interest as well? I don't know. It's just, you gotta ask these questions because supposedly we're not supposed to have conflicts of interest unless I guess you're ESPN. And I'm gonna finish it off with that thought at 40 minutes almost. I only wanted this to be 50 minutes, but you see how deep this thing can get. And I guess with my advice for FSU and Georgia Tech. Georgia Tech, yeah. Time to go. Don't let your recruiting grounds and your recruiting footprint area that you can add to a proper conference go to waste. Because really, I don't even think I'm thinking about it. I guess it'd be like only, I guess, Miami and Florida State, and like who really uses Georgia? And like I would think there would be so much more Georgia, like players from Georgia in the ACC, and I guess there are, but yeah. Send that to the Big Ten because I know those coaches will know what to do with it. Send that baby up. All right. Have a good night and see you later.